Alright, so in Honest Gaming History, we've entered the world of a lot of different fighting games. We've dabbled in Tekken, gone over some Street Fighter, gotten knee-deep into Mortal Kombat, and we're just now getting into some Guilty Gear.
But surprisingly, even though we've done over 50 episodes of the series, we have not once gotten into a game from one of the most important video game companies out there. SNK.
SNK is home to a slew of iconic series, from Samurai Showdown, which got an amazing update back in 2019, to The Art of Fighting.
And for today's lecture, we're covering the guy who pretty much became the face of the company.
Originating from Fatal Fury, it's legendary Hungry Wolf.
He's made his way into multiple games outside of his turf, including Fighting EX Lair and Super Smash Bros.
And no matter which game he enters, he always comes with the hands and the drip.
Word. This man's fit is simple, but hella clean, son.
Today in Honest Gaming History, we're covering Terry Bogard.
Play that intro, son. We just want to give a shout out to this video's sponsor, Ridge.
The Ridge wallets are some of the sleekest and sturdiest wallets you'll ever see. The durable material makes it so that this wallet will last you a lifetime, and it's able to hold pretty much everything you need in your wallet while taking up minimal space. They come in a variety of different colors and designs, and even keep your card secure from wireless theft. Check out the Ridge website and see if this wallet is the one for you. You can use the code DONTYOU to get 10% off your purchase, and you have a whole 45 days to test it. If you're not feeling it, you can send it back for a full refund. And with that being said, let's get back to the video. And thank you, Ridge, for the sponsor. So, Conscience, how you feeling about this new skin pack?
I gotta be real with you, DONTYOU. I fucks with this heavy, bro. That made me a fighting game mafia boss. Who you gotta show respect to for this one?
Well, this one was actually drawn by Art BX, or Art Banks. I'm so sorry if I said your name wrong. Appreciate you for your hard work. And both me and Conscience are really happy with these designs. Now, back to the video. Terry Bogard. Though he comes from the Fatal Fury series, this character wouldn't be a thing if it wasn't for Street Fighter. This is because of two very important creators, Hiroshi Matsumoto and Takashi Nishiyama.
If these names don't sound familiar to you, it's cool. It didn't to us either. But you should remember them from now on because these guys worked on the original Street Fighter.
That's right. Without these guys, a whole franchise, nay. A whole game genre might not have become as popular as it is today. But anyways, these guys used to work for Capcom back in the 80s, but SNK snatched them up after they finished their work on Street Fighter. Here is where they created Fatal Fury, a spiritual successor to Street Fighter that featured different gameplay mechanics and was more focused on story. To be clear though, Nishiyama is credited as the official designer of the game, while Matsumoto is credited as the sound designer.
But what does this have to do with Terry? Well, outside of this being the origin story for his game, you remember that random dude who puts a brick wall in the first Street Fighter intro? That character became the model for Terry since both Matsumoto and Nishiyama are the character's design.
Fun fact, this mystery character was later named Joe. Yes, I know, it sounds imaginary.
So they took stale-ass Joe and decked him out with the pretty boy ponytail and that iconic red and white fit, thus creating our boy.
As for his story, Terry was orphaned at a young age with his younger brother Andy. As children, they had to watch each other's back in the dangerous streets of Southtown.
You get caught slipping in Southtown, you getting jumped, my guy.
They're soon found by Mr. Jeff Bogard. He adopts the brothers and begins to raise them himself. So Terry and Annie take up the family name Bogard. However, things would not be happy forever for the new family. Prior to adopting these kids, Jeff trained in the secret Hakuyo Kuseiken School under Master Tung Fu Ru. He learned the way of the hands with his two friends, Cheng Sin Zan and Geese Howard. They studied for years. Then when the time came for Tung to choose his disciple, he chose Jeff.
This made Geese hella salty. So years later, when Terry is 10, Geese rolls up on the Bogard family and straight jumps and kills Jeff right in front of his kids. Bruh, that's not that anime shit. I don't know what it is.
As Jeff dies in Terry's arms, he and Andy vow to avenge their father and kill the evil dickhead known as Geese.
But they're kids, and they both get the vibe that Geese has no problem murdering children. So they make a deal to spend the next 10 years training to one day roll up on Geese and show him the business.
Andy decides to go to Japan to actually learn martial arts. Terry, on the other hand, decides that experience is the best teacher. So he travels around Southtown, honing the skills his father taught him by getting into street fights. But through these street fights, he manages to pick up some new tricks. And he also takes some time to train under Tung Fu Ru. Using the Hakuyo Kuseiken, he learns how to gather chi and use it in his attacks. That's how he does moves like Power Wave and Burn Knuckle. Up until I found this out, my dumbass thought he was shooting fire.
After a decade-long training arc, the crime lord Geese organizes a special tournament dubbed the King of Fighters, thus sparking the first Fatal Fury game. It's almost like he knew Andy and Terry were coming back with smoke.
The Bogard brothers reunite for the tournament, and they bring along a new friend named Joe Higashi, the Muay Thai kickboxing champion. Terry tears through the competition with his own unpredictable fighting style, created from what he learned over the years. Then he makes it to Geese, and kicks him out the window of his tower. That's what you get for killing my dad, you dick!
Now Geese is assumed dead, but in a year, someone related to him shows up with the bullshit.
Geese's half-brother, Wolfgang Krauser, hears that his brother bit the dust thanks to some guy named Terry. So he takes control of the KOF brand and organizes another tournament, but this time anyone around the world is allowed to enter. This is where we get to Fatal Fury 2.
Terry enters the tournament and is welcomed by a bunch of new faces, who he ends up befriending after whooping their asses. Like Kim Kafwan, the Taekwondo master.
He eventually gets to Krauser and shows him the same hands that he showed Geese. Then after a long, difficult battle, he defeats the guy.
And this man gets so salty about the loss that he offs himself.
Jeez, that got dark real quick. So with Krauser dead, I guess, Terry is praised as the hero of Southtown, and the city gets a sec to relax for a bit.
But that shit gets cut short when Terry hears rumors that Geese bitch ass Howard might still be alive.
Apparently the crime lord used one of these special Jin scrolls to survive the fall and help with his healing. There are three of these scrolls in total, and he wants to cash them all.
But Terry and friends aren't trying to have that, so he makes it his mission to stop Geese, thus taking us to Fatal Fury 3.
On his pursuit, he runs into someone named Blue Mary, who becomes his love interest later on.
Once he makes it to Geese, he challenges the dude again, but Geese runs away like a bitch.
So Terry continues his pursuit and runs into the Jin brothers, two others in pursuit of the scrolls, for nefarious reasons. He beats the both of them. Then he finds out that they weren't evil to begin with. They were being possessed by their evil ancestors who were trying to use these scrolls to revive themselves.
Damn, how your own ancestors gonna use you as a vessel like that?
With the twins defeated and free from their ancestors' control, Terry leaves the twin Chun-Su with his friend Kim, and the other twin, Chun-Rei, with Tung.
But they forget one very important thing. Geese got away, and he got all the scrolls.
But it's all good, because he disposes of them. Now no one could use them against him.
Oh shit, that was actually a smart villain move, Geese. And you low-key saved the world too, so you're kind of a hero for that.
But then, the need for revenge against Terry causes his blood to boil. So he reveals his presence in the public by organizing another KOF tournament.
And now Geese is back to being stupid. Bro, if you had the gall to jump Jeff, why didn't you just stay hidden and jump Terry? You fought Terry twice now. You lost the first time, and you ran away the second. Shit is not looking good for you right now, Howard.
So this starts real bout Fatal Fury. Terry rolls up in this tournament and does what he does best. Beat up the castle, he gets to the boss.
Then once he gets to Geese, he shows him why he should have kept his ass hidden and kicks him off the roof of his tower again. How many times do I gotta teach you this lesson, old man?
But Terry grabs the guy's arm before he falls. He has two definitive wins on him now. That's enough revenge for him.
But Geese gets just as butthurt as Krauser and slaps Terry's hand away, so he falls to his death.
Later, Terry runs into a little boy named Rock, who he finds out is Geese's son. He decides to take him under his wing and raise him himself as a way to put the feud between him and Geese behind. But while they're on their travels, Southtown gets in trouble again.
This dude named White, who has mind control powers, takes advantage of Geese's departure from the crime scene and tries to control the city himself.
This takes place in a game that came out exclusively in Japan, called Real Bout Garo Densetsu Special Dominated Mind.
Like many of Terry's escapades, he pulls up to the boss and defeats him, but this time he has the help of a new friend named Alfred.
After beating White, Alfred leaves, and Terry gives him his hat as a sign of their friendship. Then Southtown experiences a real period of peace this time. Many characters from the Fatal Fury cast decide to retire, but Terry continues fighting and training his apprentice, Rock.
Years go by, and it's now been a decade since Geese died.
Rock is now grown and capable of keeping up with Terry in a fight. They actually spar regularly, which is kind of wild when you think about how strong Terry is.
One day, they get invited to the King of Fighter Maximum Mayhem Tournament, sponsored by someone named Kane, thus starting Garo Mark of the Wolves.
This guy Kane was raised in the slums of Second Southtown, and he grew disgusted with the peace that developed in the area after the death of his brother-in-law, Geese.
Wait, brother-in-law? This man is related to Geese too?
Yup, this whole family is fucked up. So Kane wants to turn Second Southtown into a city-state independent of the US so he can take control of it because according to him, one does not truly experience life unless they're oppressed.
Yeah, fucked up is an understatement for these guys.
Both Terry and Rock enter because they're down for the challenge. But this time, Terry ends up losing. His boy Rock takes him out.
Afterwards, Rock goes to fight Kane, and once he meets him, Kane reveals that he is his uncle, and the main reason why he started this tournament was to fight and recruit him.
Obviously, Rock isn't down for this, but Kane offers info about his mother, so Rock joins his uncle.
Terry finds Rock as he's attempting to offer, but Rock promises that he'll return once he's done.
Although he's feeling weary about all this, Terry lets the kid go. He's grown now, and he trusts that Rock will end up like his psycho dad. And this ends Terry's story. The last time we see him, he rides off with his now love interest, Blue Mary.
But there are probably a bunch of you watching wondering, what the hell happened to KOF? Isn't Terry a prominent character in that series too? Well, King of Fighters and Fatal Fury have a weird relationship.
KOF takes from the beginning of Fatal Fury plot-wise, but it just veers off in its own direction after that. Trying to put these two timelines together would cause way too many conflicts, so it's better to just refer to this as a KOF continuity. Also, shout out to Green Lion on Twitter for recommending this dope video by Shoryu Game that did a really good job clearing this up for me. So, the KOF continuity starts after Krauser's defeat. But in this timeline, Krauser doesn't get crazy salty and end his own life. He and Geese are both alive, and out here doing the mischief.
However, these two aren't important right now. The new antagonist is Rugal Bernstein, the organizer of a new KOF tournament.
Though the names match, this tournament differs from the Fatal Fury ones. Instead of the 1v1 style, you gotta enter as a team of three. And this is where the first KOF game starts, King of Fighters 94.
Terry enters looking for the smoke, as usual, and he recruits his brother Andy and friend Joe, thus forming Team Fatal Fury.
They make it far, but they don't win since the new hero of the story is someone named Kyo Kusanagi.
Let us know in the comments if you want us to cover him in a future episode. But it's not going to be next episode. Next episode is Ryu Hayabusa, and that's going to be a lot.
So after that first KOF tournament, Terry continues to enter the multiple KOF tournaments organized throughout the years.
His main reason for attending these tournaments is to test his strength and make sure Geese isn't out here being evil.
Around KOF 99, he, Mary Blue, and some friends begin investigating a criminal syndicate named Nest.
These guys are trying to collect data from the KOF fighters and use it to create bioengineered super soldiers.
Yo, all these syndicates out here making super soldiers, son.
Oh, that's a fact. The amount of evil organizations we've covered that just want to make super soldiers is dead wild. Peeps need more creativity.
Well, luckily, Nest gets taken out, and Terry continues to enter the KOF tournaments after this.
We should also mention that, like in the Fatal Fury timeline, he develops a strong relationship with Mary.
As he enters more KOF tournaments, his normal Fatal Fury team goes through multiple changes. Sometimes his friends have other things to do.
The next time they meet for a tournament wouldn't be until KOF 13.
Then in the latest installment, KOF 14, Terry enters the newest tournament to check on the progression of his fan Alice, and to make sure Geese isn't up to no good.
And that is the end of Terry's story, in both continuities.
That continuity split was so weird though. Before this, I swore Terry played a much bigger role in KOF, but I guess I was wrong. But as for his story, I'm honestly good with this Fatal Fury continuity. I like that he did his thing as a hero in Hungry Wolf of Southtown, then trained his archenemy's son in order for him to become the focus of the story.
Yeah, it's a shame Garo Mark of Wolves never got a sequel. It was supposed to, but it got canceled after being put on hold for years.
Well, now that I know more about Terry, I'd be so down for a sequel to that. I want to find out more about Rock Howard, but there isn't much out there about him right now since the story was never finished. Let's hope that we do get more content on these Fatal Fury characters, and let us know in the comments below what other SNK stories we should get into.
But with that, end slate! What's going on, fam? Thank you guys so much for watching this new episode of Honest Gaming History. To the people that were there for that poll mishap, I am so sorry. I know I put up a poll saying, hey, who's gonna be next? Ryu Hayabusa, Terry Bogard, and Mega Man. And Ryu destroyed that competition. But I did also feel bad because, you know, as I said before, I alluded to Terry Bogard in the Ken video. I mentioned Terry Bogard a lot, and I was like, if I really do Ryu Hayabusa and just skip Terry Bogard, one, I don't know when I'm ever gonna get back to Terry, and two, like, it just felt messed up to the people that were waiting for Terry for the longest now. I know a lot of people were also waiting for Ryu, but hey, he's being done. Don't worry. Well, Terry is done. Terry's done, and now Ryu's about to get done. So, hey, it's a win-win for all friends. You just have to wait an extra week. Or maybe 2 weeks, depending on how long the script is. But if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, comment who else you'd like to see me cover in future episodes of Honest Gaming History, and hit the bell if you want to be notified whenever I upload new videos. Shout out to my patrons. Without you guys, I would not be able to make videos like this. And if you are not already a patron, but want to become one, go to my Patreon page in the description below and find out how you can support the channel for as little as $1 a month. And one of the perks you get with that is watching these videos earlier than everybody else. And lastly, as you know, if you want to keep up with me, check out my social media, which is right here. And you can also watch some other videos of me, which is on the screen somewhere. But with that being said, be easy, stay lit, Black Lives Matter, stay healthy out there. And don't forget, you can do whatever the hell you put your mind to. All it takes is practice and time. Take care, fam.